60 and W293 CX 106.5 Milwaukee.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to Community Voice. I'm your host, Keith Paris. I want to thank everybody for joining us this morning. Good morning, Keon. Good morning, Carvey.
I was going to give it to you, Frankie Stein.
Who that? The chairman of the board?
Chairman, baby. My way.
You know, when Frank Sinatra, when he would record, his go-to was Count Basie.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, Count Basie, and use Count Basie. And he did something, and Barbara Streisand did something where they actually record in the studio with either the band or the orchestra. Oh, yeah.
Really?
Yeah, a lot of people, you know, it's tracks. I'm going to sing what I'm singing. You're playing what you're playing. Everybody got the individual tracks. I was listening to some band was talking about a record they made. So we didn't even see each other. You know, you come in and do the studio
what
work.
What was that?
Earth, Wind & Fire.
Because you got to remember on Ray Charles, when he did that one song, I Believe, that's when the track it first came out. So those Frankie bands, they weren't tracking. They were big band
orchestras. Oh, yeah, big bands were.
Quincy, too. Yeah.
You know, Marvin Gaye and My Way.
Mm-hmm.
He did everything himself on that record.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, they, the making of Motown shows how he put together what's going on.
Yeah. And that's what I saw.
Yeah. And they were layering the tracks. They were how you layer the tracks, the background vocals you have. Because it's rare that all the musicians are in the studio at the same time. You know, it's layering. Well, that voice you hear is that of Mr. Greg Grotz. He is a candidate for the City of Milwaukee Comptroller. Good morning.
Good morning. How are you today?
I'm doing well, man.
Good.
Thank you for being so accommodating in the confusion yesterday.
No, you're doing me the favor. I was available for you anytime you wanted.
Well, thank you, man. Thank you. So tell us a little bit about you and why you're running for Comptroller.
Well, I'm a lifelong city resident. I lived in the city my entire life, born in the city. Grew up on the south side, went to school at St. John's Cathedral on the east side. I got a degree in business administration from Marquette. I was a Milwaukee firefighter for 28 years. The last 20 years, I was union president. Worked with both mayors, Norquist and Mayor Barrett, to try to get our shared revenue from the state, and we were successful back then. After I was on the fire union, I was appointed to the UW Board of Regents and worked with the UW Board of Regents to remodel Camp Randall Stadium. After that, I worked at the county as labor negotiator and then for the state for the Department of Employee Relations.
Are you Mr. Amon?
No, I was with Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker,
okay. Yeah. The reason I'm running is because I've been following the city politics for a long time, and it always seems like there's a budget crunch, a budget crunch, a budget crunch. They keep doing the same thing over and over again. For instance, in 2000, the city pension fund was $500 million overfunded. Fast forwarded to 2024, it's underfunded to a point where we had to get a 2% sales tax. Now, what happened in between there? You know, my position is the comptroller should be watching what's going on and knowing where the money is going. I started running because I was asked to run and of my interest to the city. And one of the things you can do, there's two things you can do. You can sit on the sideline and complain, or you can actually get up and do something. I chose to do something. It's an underfunded campaign, so it's basically retail politics. So I've been going to all the neighborhoods throughout the city. And I'm familiar with a lot of them because when I was in the field as a firefighter, I worked on 13th and Reservoir, 9th and Greenfield. I worked downtown. I worked on 26th and Scott. So I worked all over the city. And, you know, it's interesting to note that every part of the city, you hear the same thing. You know, every resident wants safe streets. They want clean streets. They want their potholes fixed. Basically, it's a quality of life issue.
And that's also a money issue then, right?
Well, it's a money issue, and that's where I feel the money is not being filtered back to the neighborhoods like it should be. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm all for downtown. Believe me, I think it's great to have a vibrant downtown. A lot of people come into the city to watch the Bucks games, to go to all the events downtown. That's great. But you got to remember, the heart and soul of the city are the neighborhoods. The neighborhoods built this city. And I believe in my heart, as I go through the city, I'm more and more encouraged for running because I don't think the neighborhoods are getting their fair share of the tax dollars. And I think the comptroller's duty is to look over where that money is coming from, what is earmarked for, and that it's being spent properly so that the taxpayers get their fair share.
There are a couple of offices that most people, most elections just voted, had no clue to what they did. We had a city attorney who was down for, I think, 34 years or something like that, over 30 years.
Right, 36 years, Grant Langley.
Still don't know who the comptroller was. And I vote. I live in the city and I vote. So what does the Office of Comptroller do?
Well, it has various expertises under the comptroller. They have the budget. They got to go over the budget. They don't do the budget, but they have to look over the budget and make sure the money's being spent properly. They audit all the city's departments. They have payroll. They do bond rating. There's 55 accountants down there. But what I've noticed and what I've learned by working in the county and the state, that usually a bureaucracy, which the people in a comptroller's office are, they get to start doing the things the same way over and over and over again. I think somebody should come in the comptroller's office and redirect them to make sure that they're looking not only to balance the books, but to make sure the money is being spent in the right places.
But now part of it, we have a mandate that we be in the city of Milwaukee, I think the county too, but we have to have a balanced budget.
That's true.
So the money is distributed, earmarked. You can't go beyond, obviously can't go beyond. And so if it's already fixed based on what you have to do, how much wiggle room do you have then as the comptroller?
Well, here's the thing. Balancing a budget is one thing. Making sure the money is going to the proper place is another thing. Now, the comptroller's office will say, well, we release our audits and we have clean audits. Well, that's true because what you said, it balances out. Now, by being transparent, think about this. I printed off the city's audit. When you print it off, it's 3 inches thick. Now, could any, you know, budgets or audits are written by accountants for accountants. You can look in those three-inch thick binder, and you're not going to be able to figure out where that money is going. if the tax money for that is spent on roads is supposed to be spent on roads, how do you know it's not being spent properly? You got to look at where the money's being spent. You got to see what DPW is doing. Are they spending the money on bike lanes or are they fixing the potholes? What affects you more, a brightly painted bike lane or a fixed pothole? I was taught, this is, it might seem trivial, potholes, but I hear that all over the city. Right. I was talking to one person she's pretty wealthy, and, it was just an inconvenience for him because he hit a pothole, had a call, have his car towed, got a loaner car, no problem. He paid for it. I was talking to another lady. It was an African-American woman who was going to bingo at the Moose Lodge on South 13th Street. And she brought up the potholes. I says, yeah, I'm hearing that all over the city. And I personally have seen it all over the city.
Oh, yeah. This is normally about pothole time, right? When callers call exactly. in and complain ad nauseam about the potholes. Now, let me say something about the bike lanes. I, too, have a problem with the bike lanes. Remember I told you my wife is a triathlete.
Right.
She loves the bike lanes.
Oh, I there's nothing wrong with the bike lanes. I'm not saying, but you have to remember the potholes are going to affect the biker, too.
That's true. I think the estimate is over $2,000 more to operate a car in the city of Milwaukee.
Right.
And that's probably damage to your car, not to mention our wheel tax. Mm-hmm. So it costs a little bit more for us to operate a car in the city.
Right. And where's all that money going? That money, the wheel tax and that should be taken and spent on fixing the streets. Because the woman I was talking about, she hit the pothole. Her car was laid up for a month. She had a go shopping by bus. She had to do everything by bus. It was very inconvenient for her. See, when you damage something, when the streets are not filled, when the potholes are not filled, it hurts the lower economically person on a, all the money flows down. Everything flows down to the lowest denominator. Taxes come down. They hit the lowest person on the totem pole the hardest. And that's what has to change. We have to change that. We have to get more money into the city, into the neighborhood, so that there's a higher quality of life for our neighborhoods, for our residents.
So and let me introduce you to my co-host on Fridays, Devon Jones, DJ.
Hey, how you doing?
Good morning.
Greg Ross, seeing you. The candidate for comptroller. You got a question? No? You got a question?
I was just wondering if the comptroller handles any grants or do grants.
Yeah, it looks over the grant and makes sure the grants are, it audits the grants, make sure the money's being spent properly.
What about the distribution of those grants?
Well, that's what's important. I think the comptroller should look over the grants, make sure they're distributed properly.
But they don't.
I don't know what they're doing right now. I'm saying that's what I would do.
The looking at part of this, you're part of the city. If elected, you're part of the city government. I've been asking people who are part of different, how would you rate the city of Milwaukee now on a scale of 1 to 10? Where would you put the city?
Well, the downtown Milwaukee, I would probably rate an 8 or a 9. But going through the various neighborhoods, the neighborhoods go from a 3 to a 5, maybe, as far as, like I say, the road conditions. One of the things that I was shocked when driving on the northwest side, it's like a ghost town almost. A lot of the places are boarded up, and it's really unnecessary. The city's got to take a look at those boarded up houses and make a decision on what to do with them.
Do you agree with the decision for the city to take Northridge Mall and demolish it?
Well, the city had the opportunity to sell Northridge Ridge Mall several years ago, and they passed on that opportunity. And
that was because of what the use was going to be, correct?
Well, I don't know why they passed on it, but the individual that was going to buy it was going to put a refurbish it and put something else in there, and that person would have taken care of it. But Northridge Mall has been a problem, and I don't think it could be remodeled, so I think that it has to be demolished. But the problem is they could have made some money on it, and now they're spending money to demolish it. That's where the comptroller comes in. The comptroller should be advising on what is a good deal. I mean, you got a mall that is not being used. You got an outside private sector company that wants to come in and buy it and refurbish it and bring in tax dollars for the city, and the city passes on it. To me, that doesn't make sense.
You know, we were talking, and I asked you, you had retired.
Yes.
So why come out of retirement at this point? I know you said you don't want to sit on the sideline and complain, but what do you bring to the table?
I bring to the table experience, you know, institutional knowledge. I've been working with the city and the state and the county for 35, 40 years. I have, you can't buy that, or you can't learn that in school. That's knowledge that you have to earn. So I have the experience, the know-how at every level of government. Every position I was in, I left that position in better shape than when I took it over. I also have the educational background, my Bachelor of Science in Business Administration from Mark Kent University. So combine those two things, and I think I'm an excellent fit for this job. And I would argue that there's not many people in city government right now that has the institutional knowledge I have of the city.
Being a proud graduate of Marquette University,
mm-hmm.
Do you want to go out on a limb and make a prediction about this evening's game against North Carolina State?
Marquette by 6.
I had to see if they are they the dog. I didn't even pull up to see what.
I don't know what it is.
I don't remember, but you said Marquette by 6.
Marquette by 6.
Now, I was laughing about that Saturday night skit they did on Dicka and David. Well,
I got to tell you, talk about Dicka. Dicka did. I've been often told I look like
you
Dicka.
Do.
I look like Dicka. Matter of fact, I saw Dicka. And he sent a picture over to me and said to my better looking brother, your friend Mike Ditka. So I'm going to a fundraiser at the 502 last night.
Okay.
And I parked the car. I'm crossing, you know, I parked the car in Garfield, aiming west. And I'm by that little street, Fifth Street. I'm parked the car. All of a sudden, a car screeches and a guy rolls down his window. Hey, Coach Ditka, Ditka. And I go up to him. I say, no, I'm not the Mike Ditka. You look like Mike Ditka. I'm sure you're Mike Ditka. I said, no, honest. I know I'm not Mike Ditka. So I gave him my card, and I says, but I look like Mike Ditka. So vote for me. Go for Greg, the taxpayer's watchdog. You can't go wrong if you got a comptroller that looks like Mike Ditka.
Wait a minute. This is Milwaukee.
We're in Milwaukee. The Bears. He's a good guy. Right. He's a good guy.
The Bears. If people want to find out more about your campaign,
go to Graz for Controller. GrazForController.com. You can donate online. Remember, vote Tuesday, the 2nd of this month of April. Go for Greg, the taxpayer's watchdog.
Appreciate you, man. Hey, Grimes. Mike Ditka's better looking brother. Appreciate you, man. Good luck.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate it.
And enjoy your resurrection weekend, man. You listen to Community Voice. We're going to take a break. We'll be right back.
We March is Women's History Month. Dr. Danita Ball was sworn in on January 6, 2023, as the 66th Sheriff of Milwaukee County. She is the first African-American female to hold the office in Wisconsin. We salute Milwaukee County Sheriff Danita Ball during Women's History Month.
This moment in women's history was brought to you by U.S. Bank. U.S. Bank has more than 50 locations in the greater Milwaukee area. Visit usbank.com to find a location near you. U.S. Bank, a member of FDIC.
The Trump economy was a disaster for Black America. He prioritized the wealthy and big business, not us, giving them tax breaks while we got left behind. Under Trump, hundreds of thousands of Black Americans lost health insurance. In the middle of a pandemic, and don't forget the division, the violence, and disrespect we faced while he was in charge. Now, he's coming after our voting rights. And if he's president again, Trump vowed to be a, quote, dictator who would get revenge. We can't go back. President Joe Biden and Vice President Kamala Harris are working hard for Black America. They sent $1,400 cash relief checks when they were needed most. Our wages are up. We've got millions of new good-paying jobs. And the cost of insulin is capped at $35 for seniors. There's more to do, but it's clear that on the economy, Black America is getting ahead with President Joe Biden and Vice President Kamala Harris.
I'm Joe Biden, candidate for president, and I approve this message.
Paid for by Biden for President.
Get ready, Wisconsin. The Black Child Development Institute is expanding its village statewide. Join us for an unforgettable evening of celebration and empowerment at our gala on Saturday, May 4th, 2024 at the Hilton Milwaukee City Center. Tickets are available for $150 per person and sponsorships are available. Adorn yourself in formal African attire as we celebrate this momentous occasion and the growth of our village. For more information and to purchase tickets, call 414-236-5641 or visit bcdi-wisconsin.org. That is 414-236-5641 or bcdi-wisconsin.org. Don't miss out on this unforgettable event. Together, let's build a brighter future for Wisconsin's children.
Attention, music lovers. Are you ready for an unforgettable night? Come out to Shank Hall, 1434 North Farwell Avenue for the Divas of Soul tribute featuring the talent Christopher's Project with guest vocalist Samira, Jess Becker, Bill Salfo Spears, and Sandra B. Doors open at 6 p.m. Sunday, April 14th. Tickets are just $25 in advance and $30 at the door. Don't miss out on this unforgettable night of soul. Grab your tickets now. For more information, call 414-276-7288. That's 414-276-7288.
Well, I've grown tired.
Milwaukee. Guess who's back? It's your man, Kevin Buchanan. Inviting you to join me each and every Friday night for the Friday Night Jukebox Party from 9 p.m. till midnight. I'll hit you with a little bit of this, a little bit of this, and of course, some of this. Each and every Friday night, it's the Friday Night Jukebox Party. From 9 p.m. to midnight, join yours truly, Kevin Buchanan, exclusively right here on 860 AM and 106.5 FM, WNOV, The Voice. You're listening to WNOV 860 and W293CX 106.5, Milwaukee. Now, back to Community Voice with your host, Keith Harris, and Devon Jones, DJ The Protege. We'll be right back. Now, back to Community Voice with your host, Keith Paris, and Devon Jones, DJ The Protégé.
All right, welcome back. And I didn't start the program off, but for those folks who are Christians, today is Good Friday, Crucifixion Friday. let me back up here for a minute.
Back up too far, you're going to be way off the mic.
Yeah, I'll be in the street, right? Mm-hmm. No, I was saying back up. I was talking about back up on what I was going to say, not literally back up. I'm forward to the mic. It's going to be pretty brutal today.
Why?
Well, because, you know, there are a lot of churches who do the last seven words of the cross, and they really, they can be very graphic in their description of Jesus' suffering on the cross. So I do know that there is a Good Friday service starting at noon at Mount Zion Baptist Church. Right there on the corner of 2nd and Garfield. Dr. Lewis Sibley is the great pastor there. So that'll be at noon today. Last seven words of the cross. So it's Good Friday. Mm-hmm. I don't know why they came up with Good Friday. I think the good was that Jesus was crucified, but I think those people sitting there witnessing that execution didn't think it was that good of a Friday. But it's really kind of fascinating how we get through it. And this is the end of Passion Week, will be tomorrow. And so again, so phone lines open 414-444-5250, 414-444-2250. It's going to be a great day for fish fry. Oh my God.
Ooh-wee.
Oh my God. It's going to be a great day.
When I get off.
Man, it's going to be a great day for fish fry. My grandmother, who was Baptist born, Baptist bred, Baptist dead, but every Friday my grandmother would have fish. It wasn't even like we were Catholic. And then when I went to high school, but it was really pronounced when I got to college, because during Lent there was no meat on Wednesdays and Fridays in mm-hmm. the cafeteria. So all the fish you can eat, but mm-hmm. there was no meat. So if you wanted meat, I'd go to the snack bar. Huh? Gefilte fish, but that'd be for our good brothers who are, if they haven't already, celebrating Passover. Yeah, you weren't there when we did the Seder. Mm-mm. No, you're a little bit older. Yeah, Amaris, surprisingly, was there. But we did the actual Seder. We tried to recreate the Seder meal that Jesus had, the Last Supper. And everything we did. And when people think about this, I would suggest go just look it up and see what it is, Passover, how you have to clean the house. Mm-hmm. And you have to, it's an amazing observance of one's religious practices. And
yeah, I was thinking on Sunday that Jesus is this crucifixion. And, you know, from the start of Palm Sunday all the way to
Resurrection Sunday.
It's like a microcosm of life. Because, you know, Sunday, Palm Sunday, Hosanna, 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 right? Those same people that was, you know, cheering them on was those same people that
crucify him.
And
Thursday.
You know, obviously we see that on a bigger stage with individuals that are, you know, influencers or entertainers, people who are in the public sphere or sphere more. But then, you know, when we just look at, you know, our own lives and the people that we deal with on a day-to-day basis, the people who are at one moment appear to be our biggest cheerleaders turn around and be some of our biggest detractors.
Smile in your face.
All the time they want to take your place, the backstabbers.
Backstabbers, you know backstabbers.
Oh, I mean, he better know that, man. That's a timeless song.
What they do?
Excuse me, sorry about that. Yeah, but how old is Backstabbers? Backstabbers over 40 years, 40 plus years old, man. Close to 50.
It got to be older than 40.
It's close to 50.
So they made that in the '80s.
No, 70s.
Right. That's older than 40.
Yeah, about 50. Yeah, backstabber.
Let me see.
Some of the stuff, you know.
That was around the Isley brother time.
The Isleys were pretty big then when they...
they're not never going to lay that down.
No Unique Q.
Here's a word, though, and I'm hating this word, and you're not going to hear me use this word only to hate on this word. I am tired of transparency. Excuse me. I hate that word. Excuse me for spitting.
52 years old.
52 years old.
I don't know why.
1972.
What, transparency?
It's not more overused than diversity.
Ooh, controversy.
Controversy.
So why is diversity overused, bro?
Because it's a myth. Diversity is a myth, especially, I mean, in a lot of cases, it's a lie when you look at, just speaking off of colleges and institutions of secondary or post-secondary education, they all tout diversity.
So what is, you said it's a lie? Diversity is real. The use of it is the lie, the way they act like they apply it.
Right.
But diversity, yeah, my neighborhood is diverse. The Hmongs, the Mexicans.
Yeah, I think that you're
Blacks, the whites.
This is here's a big word.
I don't think I ever been in an environment that was diverse.
Oh yeah.
Never?
I would.
It was either predominantly white or predominantly Black.
If you were the Black person in the predominantly white environment.
That's not diverse. No, that ain't diverse.
Okay, look. So what if it was predominantly white, but the minority Blacks rule?
Where's that happening?
A lot of inner city schools, right?
Where's that happening?
Morris, there was the Black group, there was the white group, there was Rodney and Anton Clay, there was Josh Roska and my other guy, and there was Gino Pack with the.
So what's your gripe against transparency?
I hear all politicians using it, and then when not all, sorry for being pejorative. I hear many using it. We use this term. And transparency. Here's one of the benefits of having this position is that you get a chance to talk to people who are running for office, right? And sometimes you're very impressed with the breadth and scope of knowledge, and then sometimes you're really disappointed in the level of ignorance. And these are sometimes elected officials. So when you ask them some basic questions and they can't give you an answer to that, but then they're there. So I'm hearing this term transparency. And I don't know. I mean, you just hear people saying transparency. I don't know. Maybe callers, you can tell me what that means when you hear that. Transparency. Bless you.
They don't for the half lie. It means they're going to half lie. For full transparency,
Thinking it's probably not going to be very transparent. Right, you know.
I don't mean to be offensive, but.
Right. And now it's going to be offensive. So you can kind of, but have you sit through this.
Like guess what? Guess who one of the most transparent folks that I is to me in politics?
Who that?
Donald Trump. Tell it like it is.
Nah, he be lying.
No, I didn't say lie. He's transparent. You can see through it all. He's going to tell you what he means. He just throws some lies in there for diversity.
Okay. Let me do this. The Baptist Ministers Conference of Greater Milwaukee, they're having their Good Friday services at noon today at Rock Hill Baptist Church. That's 1200 West Burleigh. So again, the Baptist Ministers Conference of Greater Milwaukee is having their Good Friday service at Rock Hill Baptist Church at 12 noon. And that's at 1200 West Valley. You know what I'm thinking. What was the address? What was our address? 1220 West Valley. Oh, Lord. Oh, man. I spent so many hours at 1220 West Valley.
Bill.
Oh, man. I remember one time your mom was Union Stewart. And this young lady, she was just a headache. And I know your mom would say she was a headache. I don't know why this woman decided to clown during the lunch hour. But Union Stewart's what you call a Union Stewart. Your mom was not very happy. She was not very happy. Because it was kind of first in here, we on this nonsense, and then you doing it over the lunch hour. I'm trying to eat my lunch. She wasn't happy at all. Transparency. Can 414-444-5250, 414-444-5250. When you hear that word transparent being used by folks who are either elected officials or running for elected office, what does that mean? Because I'm really, and then I'm waiting for them to, you know, transparency means to be clear.
Well, politics, they be lying anyway, so they
it's like a rule.
Yeah, so like anybody who's saying that they're gonna be transparent, they just lie to you right there in that sentence.
They're wearing a mask because they're saying it.
Yeah. Because isn't to be transparent, open and honest? Well, you can't talk about everything in politics.
Or should you?
You can't.
I don't know if you should.
I don't even think they let you.
Well, something. Yeah, you need to figure out a way, because there'd be a Dan Bicer or his affiliate that'll find it out if you can't do it.
You know, some Michelle say all the time, read the room, bruh. Yeah. You know, I mean, and people go, I'm just going to tell the truth. We were talking about one particular candidate, obviously very, very bright, very smart, no filters. No filters.
Guess who else is like that?
Who that?
The president of the United States.
Former president.
Well, last time I had this debate, he became president, Mr. Trump.
Yeah, well, let's hope that won't.
But the people like transparency. They like it cold. I'm not gonna say they like the truth.
Like just looking back on his presidency was historic.
And he's got room for another term.
No lie.
Oh my God.
No lie. That is an understatement. Yeah. That is an understatement.
I remember when he got elected. And I was at UWM, and there was a girl that I was in a class with, and she cried that he won.
Right.
And his first day was probably the most memorable first day of presidency of my lifetime. When he did that Muslim ban, threw the world in a frenzy.
Ever heard a president catch a march your second day in office? A million people show up.
Right.
Your second day.
Right.
Right. You catch a protest. That was indicative of where we were going. And like I said, and then doing for me on radio, he was perfect.
Hey, wait, that wasn't it. It was all the debates before that. Debates. Listen, his wife's hideous. She's just ugly. Like, come on, man.
Like,
you talk about day one, I'm talking about pre-day.
And I agree with Michelle on that. Like, there's no way you could talk about my significant other and you not have to see me. They vouching for the dude. You got to see me, man.
Are they sitting here? She's really ugly. But I was like, are they sitting here on the dais playing the dozens?
But
comedy with a comedian?
But if she ugly, that's my ugly one.
No,
you don't have the right to say she's ugly.
In the way it was going.
We got eyes.
Yeah, right.
We can't hide. We ain't blind.
Because you don't want it to be the truth. No, man. Isn't my baby so precious?
Close eyes when you bring her around.
So that's where that's why you being too transparent.
Like said,
all right.
Full transparency.
You being too transparent, because now you got these other folks in my business.
But what they say, you know, somebody tells you what you want to hear, and you tell your friend. Right. Friends are going to tell you, look, man, you need to go take a bit of dentist.
I know you love him.
His teeth are very diverse.
But as Maurice White said, lover's eyes are blessed to only see the best. So, you know, and why we on it? LTD, what we got?
Yeah. Did not try to get some dark shades. I ain't seen nothing.
Interesting, though, you talk about defending your woman.
Mm-hmm.
The Smiths, Will and Jada, are closing their foundation because they can't raise money because of him hitting Chris Rock. So they have not been able to raise money, and so they're closing their foundation. That's what you get for defending your woman.
He need to go to another room. I bet you if he take it to the ghetto, he'll get all the money they was getting to slap him again.
I mean, do they really need the foundation?
They do good work.
Right, they helping out other people, so they... Y'all not trying to accept
that. And there's another bad boy coming out.
I'm going to see it.
Oh, they're going to be in wheelchairs. Come on, man.
Martin going to be in a wheelchair.
That's cool.
I think they put that in the script.
Okay. Welcome to the program.
What's going on, man?
What's happening, man?
Good morning.
So, y'all talking about diversity. Wait, before I do that, RIP Louis Gossett Jr.
Oh, my God. He
passed?
He been dead. Yeah.
No, those guys that ain't been dead. No. Those guys have been old since the 20s.
I thought he been dead.
No, he was just in The Color Purple.
Yeah.
For real?
Chicken George, right? No, that Chicken George, Ben Vereen, he was...
Man, I've been thinking he's big gone.
No. But who was he in Roots? He was in Roots.
He was Fiddler.
Fiddler, thank you. I knew he was in Roots.
Hey, remember up on Martin when Tommy was stepping up for Pam? Mm-hmm. And he was like, hey, man, you're going to have to lay off on the insults. And Martin was like, well, what's it to you, Lou Gossett?
He just passed the day. May he rest in peace. Also, he won Academy Award.
Oh man, well, rest in peace,
gentleman. Or he was nominated, right?
I thought he already was gone. So no. That's my bad.
Okay.
No, you did, bro. What Keon say? He played all the old roles. He been old.
He been old.
Yeah, after Fiddler, you know it was.
It's like Morgan Freeman. Morgan Freeman, he been old too.
Wait, wait a minute.
Yeah, he did win the Academy Award for that.
Yeah, that's the voice of God.
Morgan Freeman
dies, the voice of God dies.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, that is the voice of God.
Yeah, him and Louis Gossett, the oldest actors in the world.
Yeah.
Morgan Freeman definitely older than him. He 117.
Yeah, but, no, he not even look old.
No, he 117.
Actually, he looks good.
He was looking old when he was young.
Yeah, right. He did. At 12 years old, he looked at 37.
So Louis Gossett was 87.
What was the name? He used to call me Crazy Joe, but then they called him Batman.
Lean on me.
Yeah,
it's on. I think it's on Netflix now. Lean on me. Yeah,
Joe Clark.
You know what's very interesting about Joe Clark though? His daughter, what's her name? Jolene.
He's a year younger.
Was a Olympic. Runner, I think she ran the 400 meters. Mm-hmm. Her daughter now is running.
Okay,
I mean they were. So yeah, Joe Clark.
Lewis was
and y'all was talking about diversity. In my condo complex, you see black people, white people, Asian, Indian people, Mexican people. That's what I mean diversity. Right. Like I'm the only black dude there, and there's some white people. That's not diversity. I'm with you, DJ.
I think that is diversity.
Oh, bro.
I don't know what group should have an advantage.
It has to have a solid proportion.
It gotta have a mix of people. Some whites, some Mexicans, some Indians, it just can't be done. It gotta have a solid proportion.
Yeah. That's not that.
Yeah, a bunch of folks.
They say that up at a lot of colleges that we graduated from.
You know why?
Yeah, right? It was diverse.
That's how it was here when you go to a place where like New York, Arizona, Chicago, where it's diverse, where it's all different kind of people, not just one white dude and a bunch of black people. That's not diverse.
You look at certain colleges' websites, it looks very diverse until you step on campus.
Until you get there, they're going to have their own culture.
Right.
Where are the black people?
Well, it could be a
in
diverse
that picture.
It could be a diverse area. It could be a diverse
community.
All
the black people you see in the pictures, all the black people on campus. We got them all in the picture.
But it could be a diverse community in a diverse area, but, you know, birds of a feather flock together. You know, you may see them on the park, but the ducks and the geese, they're going to roll with each other. They're not going to be mixed and mingled. You know what I'm saying? So,
no, I ain't say that, but still, when you go to black events, but still, right. Most of the time, events here, you going to run into everybody.
Yeah. So is Milwaukee a diverse city?
No.
It's more diverse than it has been.
Well, it's certain. Okay. Certain parts like Brady Street or something.
No. I didn't say the street. I said, is Milwaukee a diverse city? Because once again, I'm going to be with my people. I'm not. Some people want to wander, but is it a diverse city as a whole?
I don't think it's diverse because north side is black people, south side is the Mexicans.
That's segregation.
It's a diverse city.
That's
not diverse
because everybody on the south side ain't Mexican. They everything black, Somalian. You thought they were until you talked to them. It's like New York. You thought that was your brother from Harlem. He was like, I'm about to do
Dominican Republic.
Right. What you mean? He don't speak your English.
You talking about some black people that look like black people. Here's the DR. Like those dudes come in from the Dominican Republic. They look like Puerto Ricans.
It's all the Caribbean.
Yeah, but
it ain't just the DR.
Oh, I would say Jamaica, Bahamas.
That was my point. Like places can be diverse. That, you know, just, you know, it can be segregated too. And it ain't necessarily segregated. I mean, once again,
If you look at the
city, I'm a geek. I'm not hanging out with the jocks.
It's certainly more diverse than when I was a kid, where we were only 10% of the population. 90% of the population was white.
But it was diverse. But guess what? You saw white. White people saw Polish, Irish, right. German. Right. They not what we think they are.
So how I view diversity is it a whole pot, and is it a variety of ingredients in that pot? Not to say that this pot or those ingredients mix with each other. That's two totally different things. But is that pot filled with other ingredients or many other ingredients? Right. And so to have that analogy with Milwaukee, the answer is yes. Now, yeah, you got your north side, you got your south side, you got your uptown, you got your downtown, you know, you got all of that. But as far as the diversity of the city as a whole, yeah. Now, is it segregated? Yeah. And like Keon always says, two things can be true.
It's separated. It's not segregated anymore. It's separated.
It's still some segregation.
What I mean, it's separated because you can move where you want to. It's pretty economics. Much. It's economics. But it's separated because people stay in the areas. I know rich cats living in, you know, I'm talking about good six figures for a few years, cats living in the hood still, you know, wearing greasy overalls, working on cars. So you don't want to leave them, go over there by deer.
That's an interesting question. Do you, what obligation do you have in terms of a city where you live? And are you,
as far as what?
Well, some people are more intentional where they want to be in a black neighborhood, and they will, or they like a certain part of the city. Others, you know, argue that, hey, I want to do something different. For me, I was a county employee. So, I mean, I had to live in Milwaukee County. Then we still had residency. but I don't know now.
You didn't go all the way over there?
I would say until 2020, I've never been on the south side.
I lived on the east side for 10 years.
Yeah, but I mean, other cities you could have went to that you didn't go to?
I did not. You know, and that's an interesting piece, because somebody asked me that the other day. He said, would you consider relocating? And I thought, at this point, I told my buddy, I said, I admire him because he wrote relocated at 60, you know, where he just went to.
Until 2020, I never stepped foot on the south side. You know, I had got a job that my initial office was on the south side. I'm like, whoa, this, because it was always out of my jurisdiction.
Always,
you know what I'm saying? But ever since 2020, all of my offices has been on the south side. So I've been able to just see and experience more. And then just being a kid, you go on field trips and stuff, you're like, damn, this far. But now as an adult, I'm like, oh, man, I used to be over here. You know what I mean? So
I cried when they told me I just graduated from our class, and I thought I was going to be going to 5th and Hadley, the old Cox Center, Cox Health Center. And they said, no, they need to diversify. So they're going to send me to the south side. Man, I remember, because we had a history, that viaduct, right? Mm-hmm. And so, but dude, I got on the south side and loved the south side.
Yes.
It was so diverse in terms of looking at different, you know, Mexicans, Puerto Ricans, whites, blacks, Asians. It was a different look. I hate walking into.
My nerves still get bad when I be on the south side.
Is that right?
I'm just ain't familiar with the south side, even though I've worked over there, but I don't be kicking it over there. I get in, get out.
My father was a traveler like that. So, you know, my god sisters and brothers, you know, white kids, them and my dad had a back-to-back fight on 8th at the gas station. When the white guy owned it back in the 70s. So you know what I'm saying? So
we were back always to back fight.
They had a back-to-back fight with the owner, you know, about some stuff. The dude said some racial stuff. He finally told me the story. And Tim back-to-back with him. Name is Tim Rogers, go figure. He was an old wrestler. He just looked like an old wrestler. But yeah, so I've been going to the South Side for a long time, then going to a diverse school, you know, at the same time. You go see your partners. You know, now, the cat that's on 84th and Hampton that live on the south side, you go see him and then you get a pass. Right, hey, he's good.
We'll differentiate between the south side and then South Milwaukee.
Oh, that's different.
That's definitely different.
Oh, dude, it is. Cudahy.
Mm-hmm. That's definitely different.
It's funny you were talking about the ethnicity of Europeans, and you're right, because, you know, we look at the world and go, all white people are the same.
Nobody.
And then we find out, no. And that's why I mean, Michelle
but isn't
and I
was it a book that talked about that?
Oh, called History. Books. Yeah. History.
I'm talking about
I did, killing folks.
But you know, it was like it was something like when Italians became white or something like that.
Yeah,
when some people became white.
Talks about how what whiteness is, and I have a Black History Month, a couple of books, the invention of the white race. What is the other one I have by Neil Painter?
What did they say? The Irish were the niggers of Europe?
Yes.
They just say that. They say that you were the niggers of Europe.
The word hunky was used for Eastern Europeans, Hungarians, and so they would call them hunkies, right?
I thought, you know, they was trying to pull up for some...
It was a different kind.
Oh. You know, okay. I thought that's what, you know, they pull up for...
And I think that when if you spend time among people and then you begin to...
We call them hunkies.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. We talking about two different people. Yeah,
but then what you find out is that these folks have such rich, all these cultures, ours included. I mean, they're so rich when you get in, get away from the white supremacy piece and just go in and experience different people. And you find out like, wow, the world is bigger than my little spot.
And you know, that word wasn't just for that. Cause I remember my sister was in high school, boy come honk the horn, pops be like, this ain't no whole house.
You right.
Better not go out that door. Yeah. Where you going? I'm all right outside. No, you ain't. You better walk to that door. Ain't no honkies over here.
That's okay. I'm going to come to the door.
Oh, yeah.
I'm still going to do what I'm going to do to your daughter. Call her. I'm going to come to the door. Okay.
That's cool. At least he know who to kill.
You listen to Community Voice Call. I see you. Be patient. We're going to grab you right after the break. We'll be right back.
Milwaukee, we are about to enter one of the most important election seasons of our lives. 2024 is going to be pivotal. Here at WNOV, we work to ensure that our listeners are informed, knowledgeable, and engaged. On Tuesday, April 2nd, tune in from 3 to 8 p.m. for another edition of Election Central. Hear from candidates, discuss ballot referendums, and get real-time election updates and report problems throughout the course of the day. We are ready, and you should be too. Election Central on WNOV, 860 AM, 106.5 FM, sponsored by Souls to the Pulse.
Hey, Milwaukee, this is Mandela Barnes. You probably know me as the former Lieutenant Governor, but I'm also a proud product of Milwaukee Public Schools and a proud son of a Milwaukee Public School teacher. And that's why I'm supporting Yes for MPS. We have strong public schools. We have strong communities. We have a strong workforce, and everyone can succeed. For years, we've seen Republicans in the legislature continue to fail Milwaukee students by withholding resources that force devastating cuts to our schools. This referendum is our chance to stand up for our kids and provide them with the opportunities they deserve and say yes to their futures when so many have told them no. If the referendum fails, consequences for our children, our parents, our educators, and for the future of our city will be dire. So let's do our part, Milwaukee. Join me in voting yes for MPS on April 2nd.
Paid for by the Vote Yes for MPS Committee.
If you're looking for mouth-watering eats and delectable treats, look no further. Eat local and visit the Sherman Phoenix today, where you can find everything from delicious organic wings and smoked barbecue to satisfyingly seasoned vegan food to sweet, buttery, made-to-order desserts. The Sherman Phoenix is also home to a day bar serving mixed, frozen, and tropical drinks. Experience the Sherman Phoenix effect at 3536 West Fond du Lac Avenue, open Tuesday through Friday, 11 a.m. to 7 p.m., and Saturday, 10 a.m. to 7 p.m. Visit theshermanphoenix.com to learn more.
The Center for Teaching Entrepreneurship presents its third annual Big Head Soiree Thursday, May 16th at the Marcus Performing Arts Center in the Bradley Pavilion. I'm Andrea Williams, and I'll be your host for this spectacular event. It's designed to salute the co-founder, Miss Radonna Rogers, as she loved to wear big hats, and this is one way we honor her. We will also celebrate and recognize the accomplishments of Milwaukee's leaders in entrepreneurial ventures.
TTE was founded with the mission in mind to help young people understand business, financial literacy, and themselves, and how they can find their way into the marketplace and be productive citizens. We have found a great way to educate, stimulate, and advance what we're doing within this community.
So, ladies, this is the time to wear your big hat, and guys, your stylish fedora. You will be treated to a delectable dinner and the sounds of Soul Sirius starting at 5:30. The program will begin at 7 with more entertainment and the awards program. Tickets are just $75. Go to Eventbrite using VHS24 or call 414-788-8104. That's 414-788-8104. This event will kick off the spring season, so don't miss it.
This event is sponsored by Wisconsin Black Chamber of Commerce, U.S. Bank, Brewers Community Foundation, and Vistar.
What's up, Milwaukee? It's me, Mr. Debo, your host of the Blues Cafe. I'm inviting you to join me each and every Saturday right here on the all-new 860 WNOV and 106.5 for the best blues this side of the Mississippi. Think of a little of this.
It's been too long. Much
and a little of that. And at 11 o'clock, it's the Burnt Toast and Coffee Check. Your chance to take over the show and become the host for just a few doggone minutes. Saying happy birthday and give your son send out condolences. I'm not sure of what it is, but you're invited to join us. We've got interviews with some of your favorite artists. We'll feature new music. It all happens each and every Saturday from 9 until 2, right here on 860 WNOV at 106.5 FM.
WNOV 860 and W293 CX 106.5 Milwaukee.
It's not gonna fly.
too proud. Go ahead, figure it out. So cold, make the North Pole move down south.
W293CX 106.5 Milwaukee. Now back to Community Voice with your host Keith Harris and Devon Jones, DJ the Protege.
All right, welcome back, caller. Thank you for your patience. Welcome to the program.
Yeah, I got big patience this morning with y'all with all of it. I just wanted to comment on this word hunky and living. And this young man said he lived in a place where there's all kind of people and he's the only black person out there.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Did he feel neglected or rejected or anything, you think?
He was just talking about the diversity in his housing complex.
That's diversity or is that integration? He made it integration when he moved in there. I'm not sure why people just automatically think just because I have money, I can move there. But I think they forgot about open housing and all that old kind of stuff. You know, the history of Milwaukee and all that.
He's in Arizona.
He's in Arizona.
Oh, he's in Arizona. I didn't catch that part. I'm sorry. And I wanted to comment about the word honky.
Mm-hmm.
And when I was coming up, because people were, you know, taunting people with the N-word, that seemed to be, you know, it seemed to be a regular vocabulary word with some people that I lived around at the time. And even, you know, even every once in a while, I will hear it now. But it's used in a different vein or whatever, but not coming out of people's mouth that don't look like me. So I can rest my case. I'm not resting a case on any of it. And about the Reverend showing how he's just a regular guy. I'm speaking of you, Reverend Parrish. When you're walking around, you Keith, and if people recognize you from the church, you're Reverend. You made about getting to somebody's daughter. Now, 40 years ago or 50 years ago, that would have been unheard of. You didn't hear Reverend saying anything or being that open. I don't think, because I never heard anybody. They used to have their own personal Reverend jokes or something. I don't know. But whatever the case may be.
Was that being transparent?
I don't know what you call it, because I can spell transparency. But
how's that being?
But today, I guess it would be, well, he said, so-and-so getting at somebody's daughter. If you had said that 40 years ago, how do you think that would have went?
What, I was getting with somebody's daughter?
Yeah, you know, and you were a reverend, and they had a radio station that was like this, had an open forum, you know.
Well, they had pastors on that end that was getting their folks' kids and daughters that they just weren't talking about.
Yeah, I mean, well, if I'm single and dating, yeah, I mean, let's just be real. I mean, if the act as if I wasn't having adult relationships when I was an adult would be a lie. And so why act as if that didn't happen? All I'm saying is, as nice as I was to her parents, she and I had our own relationship, right? So.
Yeah. Yeah,
but yeah, but I'd always go. I'd never honked. I would never come up and honk to pick you up. I'm gonna come to your door. I'm gonna hopefully get a chance to talk to your parents. And you know what? I was the type of guy, you know, when that was still important, I'd get her home when. But then at that point, we're adults, so she get home when she get home. So.
Right. Absolutely. But I don't think I was going for that stretch of land there. I was just going on the 40-year deal. And yes, it was a lot going on then that wasn't exposed in the public, but it was, you heard the little conversations or whatever. But whatever the case may be, it all came to the light of, because of media and the way it is now, this all came to light. But on a better note, this is a Holy Week, and this is Good Friday, and let's not forget what the real reason for Easter, what Easter is really all about.
by Easter bunnies and giving.
It's not about Easter bunnies. It ain't about the
bunnies laying eggs.
The jelly beans and
yeah,
all that.
Yeah,
Cadbury. Some people are, yeah. But I, you know, regardless of, you know, everybody celebrates in a different way. But I think when it comes down to certain, well, when it comes down to those spiritual people, those spiritual folks will, you know, will celebrate the Easter like it's, you know, will celebrate the this time of the year in a special way. You know, they, you know, because they're they have done their Bibling and they have done their spiritual, they've done their praying, and they, when it comes to, you know, certain times of the year, this is what they do. And this is that time where those people, you know, where, you know, they just follow the book. So, and that's what I got for that one.
But, do you know why Jehovah's Witness do not celebrate Christmas or Easter?
You know, I have, there's people, I, you know, I didn't get into it because I didn't understand Trinity.
No, Jehovah's Witnesses doesn't believe in the Trinity.
Oh, okay. Okay. They don't
believe
reason
why I can answer it. The reason why is because Christmas and Easter as holidays do not appear in the Bible. And
oh,
in
okay.
their minds it is. And that's trying to figure out or get meaning to what this whole Passion Week should represent.
Yeah.
But yeah, it really was in some instances about the Easter Bunny and eggs and spring and renewal. And that was part of under Constantine, where Constantine allowed certain mm-hmm. pagan celebrations be a part of what we call Christianity. And
okay.
Easter and Christmas were those two that mm-hmm. that kind of stands out. So I think we have to give meaning to it. But if we
okay.
look at initially, it was based on the crucifixion and resurrection. But now, after 2,000 years, it's kind of turned into something else.
Yeah, yeah. And I've only been around this, you know, from the 1900s to the 2000s so far. I've been blessed with this day, another day again. But, you know, since you gave me a history, every day I learn something, and I'm so glad you're so articulate that I can, you know, I can call the radio station and pull information from you, because you come from a different set of, you got all kind of recommendations of books. I mean, all I'm not going to say all the co-hosts, but I'm saying there's a wealth of information out here, and people never stop talking about relevant things, mm-hmm. you know, and stop with the nonsense and go on. Let's go on, get the real party started and getting unity together. And I think this is something that people need to, you know, start to really, as the sun shines and everything unfolds and the flowers bud and everything, that they need to take into consideration. Maybe I need to do something, with wellness for community and everything around me. So I wish all of y'all a safe and prosperous week's end and weekend, and have a good, I guess, Easter Sunday and Saturday.
Yep. And you know what we won't be doing on Easter Sunday? We will not be serving pork. Jesus didn't eat pork.
Right.
Now, this is really interesting how the stars line up, and this really is how the stars and the moon lines up. Right now, we've gone through Passover. We've had this overlapping of all the Abrahamic religions in terms of a holiday. So we've had Passover, we had Ramadan, and we have Easter. And it's one of those times where all three of the Abrahamic religions, their different celebrations overlap with each other. And so,
oh my God.
Yeah.
So I'm going to commit a sin eating. I'm going to be more sinful eating ham on Sunday.
No, Jesus died so you could eat pork.
I should get my chicken ready then. Okay.
No, Jesus died so you can eat pork. I just thought it was ironic that we'd be eating pork on Easter, when Jesus didn't eat pork. So, one year we did, if you go into stores now, we did do lamb one year.
Yeah.
I was in the store and I saw that they do have these huge lamb, what do you call them? Maybe a lamb chop. They're huge. I mean, these big pieces of lamb. So It's interesting. Appreciate you.
Oh, okay. Well, thank you so much, Reverend Parrish. And like I say, are you preaching on Sunday or what?
No, I am not.
Oh, wow.
No, I'm not. Oh. I did Palm Sunday.
Oh, you did Palm. So I missed it. I didn't know you were preaching Palm Sunday. I must not have been listening too good because I would have ran for that. But I'm going to catch you on a summer Sunday. You know, I'm going to catch you on a summer Sunday and see how you preach. And if you don't do it right, I'm going to get up in the middle of the church and say, you could have did better than that, Reverend Parrish. What was you waiting on?
You're gonna bring a contribution, right? I mean, so if you get up and say that, but you wrote the check, I'm cool.
I always contribute when I go to church. When I go to church, I contribute. I drop it. I tell you.
I saw something a little while ago where a brother got up and thanked God they did his love offering before he preached. Because they would have did that love offering after he preached, he was walking out there with a whole lot. So, so get that love offering there. Well, have a good resurrection weekend.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
All right.
Bye-bye.
All she wanted was a quickie.
Call and welcome to the program. One of the greatest songs I ever heard preached.
Well, the first thing I want to say to all y'all, I want you to have a weekend as if you are human. I want you to do everything you are big enough to do. If you're going to have a drink, have the best damn drink of your life. If you're going to get out of them streets, get out of them streets. If you want to get out of them streets and get them yam yams, tam tams, pam pams, and go back and get some more yam yams, tam tams, and pam pams to chase it with 3 shots of Hennessy, I want you to do it hard and do it good. I just want you to live your life because you only got one life to live and don't live it with no restrictions. And if anybody can condemn you, you tell them you can watch because I'm going to do me. All right. But moving forward, what I was going to tell you, we are all ugly to somebody. That's why you create your audience, which is just for you. And then also, I was going to say, I respect people who speak with no filter because they're going to tell you straight from their heart with no chaser. So I should have the same opportunity to speak the same way with no filter without being condemned. And I think if we as Black people, especially in our community, did that, we will probably have the respect we will have. But because we don't speak from our heart, don't say that. They're listening. Well, guess what? Let them listen because I'm going to let them hear something they really need to hear. But if Black people start living life and speaking from their true heart and not worrying about what other people think, I think it would be a better place. But like I said, have yourself a great weekend and do everything you big enough to do. Right. But just don't take no shower with no hotel soap. Okay. Have a good one.
Even if it's still in the package.
Hey, that's hoping it's going good, man. He ain't lying. All it do is add a film to you.
All right, so bring your own soap.
B-Y-O-S.
Bring your own soap.
Oh, that was the one right there.
It was like when we were one of our prize giveaways. I don't know if it was Mother's Day or Valentine's Day, was the Red Roof Inn. And boy, and what we say, and you can spend the night.
somebody called and said, "Well, my other ticket." I said, "It's a open the door."
Right.
You know what the Red Roof is? That's the Stop and Shop.
Do people know you can actually spend a night at a Red Roof Inn?
I don't request it. I mean, recommend it.
Did
they
get some champagne with that?
Oh, man. One Valentine's Day, man, that was more than what? Close to $500 when you looked at
it. But that whole package would make that Red Roof Inn room look like the Hyatt.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, package itself. So you can fool somebody.
Once you go through the basket and you start,
you said what? You can fool somebody.
None of mine. Mine would have been like, Nick, I'm not getting out the car.
Oh, you funny though. You say you can fool somebody.
Well, what for?
At least 4 stars, partner.
He said, you can fool somebody.
250.
What your blindfold on, baby?
Right. I said, surprise. Surprise.
Surprise, surprise, surprise.
Remember, you said, I don't surprise you enough.
Oh, here it is. Red Roof Inn. And we could spend the night.
Well, your room is right by the car.
And the sink is in the room.
Right.
The sink is in the room. Call him. Welcome to the program.
Good morning. You on air?
Hey, good morning. I hear you guys having a great time on this Good Friday. Good Friday for us, bad Friday for him. How about that?
Who's him?
So, Jesus Christ. You know, in our belief, you know, Jesus was crucified, and that's what makes him significant than all the other supposedly prophets and sons of God that were sent here on this planet, because this one was crucified. And then what makes it so unique and so magnificent above all the rest, he raised from the grave and showered by witnesses seeing him be lifted up. Now, you know, I know there's a lot of controversy behind it. But let's be realistic. When he was on the cross, what were the last seven words he murmured, Keith, but preacher?
So you gonna start the hooping?
No, I want to know what the last seven words were, and or which word does he like the best?
Who, me?
Yeah.
You know, last year it just fell that I was doing, I think I did three Sundays back-to-back during this time, and so I had a series of messages called Messages from the Cross, where, you know, we would extract different things. And a lot of it, I was just sharing this yesterday, a lot of that was reading James Cone's book, The Cross and the Lynching Tree, and trying to get an understanding of what the crucifixion actually was. I mean, we look at it as, oh, Jesus died to save us from our sins. Okay, that's post-crucifixion. Prior to crucifixion, and what got Jesus on the cross in the first place was that Jesus was a threat. Oh yeah, I did see the Book of Clarence.
Right.
I did see the Talk Book of Clarence. And I don't know if you've seen it, Meech, but remember when there's a scene where he's before Pilate and he's talking to Pilate and he says, look, I'm not the Messiah. I was just doing this. I was just gaming, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And Pilate didn't trust him. And Pilate said something that gives us a whole indication of what crucifixion was about. He said, what you're going to do is go out there and stir up the people. Now I have to crucify you because you were a threat to the Roman Empire. You were a threat to the Jewish hierarchy who were exploiting people. And so Jesus represented a threat to Rome. Jews did not crucify Jesus. Rome crucified Jesus.
Right.
Okay, can I say this to you? First of all, see, when you go into that right there, then you might as well throw the whole idea of having a deity through Christ away. Because now what you did is you went in and you dissected, you become knowledgeable. You become so knowledgeable that stuff is like crazy, man.
He wasn't knowledgeable before?
No. What I'm saying to you is that, you know, DeSantis said the kids at 14 down south need to be off of TikTok and all the rest of that stuff. Look here. Look what it has done for us. But I'm getting sidetracked from where I called in.
Get back in the yard.
The thing was,
no, Keith never answers your question, though.
That's why I was trying to go back to the last seven words. And what's his favorite words? Christ called out from the cross. Now we can get into the hanging of the tree.
I can give it to you. Forgive them, for they know not what they do. And I think the consequences.
That's a good one. That's when he screamed out.
Consequences. Me. That was the first thing. Wasn't that the first word? Forgive them for they
know. No. Eli, lama shabbat.
My God, why have thou forsaken me? The 22nd Psalms.
Mm. Right.
I'm just saying the basis of it. But the reason why I really like forgive them, for they know not what they do. And one of the messages, Keon was at that message, is unintended consequences. That what people thought that they were doing, they thought that they were in effect, and they did in the immediate, it tramped down the threat that Jesus posed to the Romans and to the Jewish hierarchy. But what they did not know 2,000 years later, that you would have a religion based on the very person that you crucified. Who would have thought
okay,
that?
Okay, listen, Doc. Doc, I asked you a question. You gave me yours. Now I'm going to give you mine. You said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Mine would be the fourth word. Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. My God, why has thou forsaken me? And listen, that ties into what you just got through saying, because some people like to say Jesus was hollering up, talking to God, saying, God, why have thou forsaken me? But he might have been talking, that word thou was in exchange, talking to the people that was on the ground if they're crucifying him. Now, when you use the word crucifixion, remember, the Romans did not create crucifixion. The Carthaginians created the actual act of a crucifixion, okay? The Carthaginians, because they believed that a diabolic criminal blood should not hit the ground, and those bodies were really left out on the cross to be picked away.
Why did Rome utilize crucifixion?
Well, because at that simple, it was adoption from what I'm telling you.
But why did Rome use it? What was the purpose of Rome doing the way they did crucifixion? Why did Rome do it the way Rome did it?
I'm giving you, they adopted that from the Carthaginian people.
No, you need to look at your own history of your people. Rome used the cross to say, if you do this, anybody else, this is what's going to happen to you. That's why it was done very publicly.
It really wasn't a cross, though. It was a tree.
It was a tree. And there's some issues with that. But what Rome was doing was sending a message. It's the same thing the slave master did when he would punish a slave in front of other slaves. Say, if you cross the line, this is what happens to you. This is Jesus. That is real. That is real.
See, listen, brother. Jesus, listen to this right here now. Remember, they let Barabbas go free, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because Barabbas was look at the meaning of his name. He was a revolutionary. See what you have at the cross here. You have a Dr. King.
Wasn't he a Malcolm X? He
was a Maccabean. Hold on, I'm going to show you something here, you might be able to catch this. Okay. Catch on to this. You have a Dr. King, Jesus Christ. Then you have a Malcolm X, which was a revolutionary. Right. Barabbas was a revolutionary and a murderer. Those people didn't want Jesus coming there. They were looking for a hero to save them out the hands of the Roman government. See, that white boy been in power a long time. Jesus was too passive for him. They couldn't get with him. The Jews are still waiting on the Messiah to come raise up and do this. They might say this dude Netanyahu going to be the Messiah as he get through running rapid over some of the Ishmaelites. Listen, brother, they've been looking for a savior. That's the reason why they don't accept him right now.
Black people are looking. Black people have the same messianic desires that those people exhibited last Sunday when they yelled, Hosanna, Hosanna. Hosanna means to save, help now. These folks were looking for liberation from the Romans. We done turned it into this whole thing. We're doing it through the lens of religion. Take it out the lens of religion and look at what was happening in terms of history at that time, because that becomes important to understand. That when you take and look, Jesus never ever criticized the Roman Empire. When they came to Jesus asking Jesus about taxes, what did he say? Render unto Caesar that which is Caesar, render unto God which is God. So Jesus's issue was with the religious leadership of the Jewish people. That was his primary issue.
Question then,
he never criticized Rome.
501c3 coming from when they're trying to get around taxes. And guess what? Jesus said, "Render unto Caesar what Caesar." He told the boy, "Go down there and catch a fish, man. First fish you pull up, dig in his mouth and take that money, man,
and pay taxes."
Has the church fallen into a thing where they cannot, their hands have become tied, their mouth has become stitched together, they can't talk because they have took a tracking number called a 501c3. By the way, churches, if you're listening, you don't even need a 501c3 to be tax exempt because you're automatically qualified. But once you take that number, then you are beholden.
You take the number so I can get credit.
They can come in and even ask you for an audit. Because guess what? You have something that belongs to them.
No, they're protected.
Brother, you don't got to have no 501c3 to be a church.
But if I want to give my parishioners credit for their contributions, I need a 501c3.
The parishioners are just as corrupt and contaminated as the church, because now you're trying to get two plates. You're trying to get a blessing from God, plus get your blessing back. I've never been with that. Fill out my tax form at church. Dude, you out of pocket for that. Because guess what? Now you're trying to get a double whammy. You want a blessing from God, then you want some of your money back.
Can you do both?
Can you do both? Let's think about this thing.
Because maybe that's taxes. Maybe God's not involved with taxes.
No. He done told you.
I thought we were talking about the seven words, man.
Jesus was Caesar.
Right. I thought we were talking about taxes. The seven words.
But we need to get back to
how we get to this.
How Jesus really got into trouble. And Jesus got into trouble because Jesus was a threat.
Three things I know, DJ, that you won't be able to confuse me. The women, how to count money, and that Bible.
Okay.
You're not going to confuse me
You just can't read the Bible.
No, I've studied the Bible.
No, you just can't study the Bible. You have to look at sources over and beyond the Bible. And that's the problem that people have because people will look at the Bible. Look at the Bible. And here's something, and this is controversy. Controversy? Here's the controversy. Stop worshiping the Bible. The Bible is not God. And there are a lot of people who worship a book. Practice the book. Don't worship the book.
Did you not hear his order? He said women, money, then the Bible.
I ain't heard God. It all starts there. And so when people are talking to me about I'm a Baptist. They call Baptists people of the book. We know the Bible cover to cover. The problem is we don't live the Bible. So stop worshiping the Bible and start living the Bible. That gives the Bible real power. All this other stuff.
Do you believe Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sin and God?
We just sat up and talked about Jesus died on the cross, man. Where are you going with that?
Do you believe Jesus raised from the dead?
He gonna be raised from the dead Sunday.
You want to baptize
him. Do you believe he was raised from the dead?
Do I believe that he was raised from the dead? Do I accept the resurrection? Is that what you're asking
me? Do you accept the resurrection?
Yes. But that had nothing to do with me following the preach. You know, my brother pointed something out to me that I had mentioned. I didn't think it was that profound. He said, you know, Jesus did live before he died. His point is Jesus did all these things. But Jesus did not come. If you read, he did not come to die. He ended up dying. And you say, well, where you get that from? Because when you go and read the first sermon that he preached out of Isaiah, right? He come to set the captives free. Right. So Jesus did. And he was teaching us that's why forgiveness is the one message that I really take from the cross among the others. Forgiveness becomes important. Right. So Jesus, and this is what I said, here's the difference between Jesus and all of us.
That was his purpose, though.
The Jesus exemplified the things he taught. So when he talked to Peter about the number of times that one should forgive, when he was on the cross, In the middle of agonizing pain, he said, forgive them, for they know not what they do. There then becomes the power of forgiveness, even in the midst of pain and anguish, that you have to look beyond that pain and anguish to forgive someone. That is one of the messages that should be coming from the cross. But let's start talking about how easy it is to forgive somebody.
Bless you.
Listen, you know something? Out of all of that, I got to ask myself, Keith, why have you forsaken God?
Okay, appreciate you, man. Caller, welcome to the program.
Where did he get that from?
His concept of God and his understanding of God.
Same way I be getting that, Keith.
Yeah, okay. The catechism, your religious teaching.
Catechism.
There's something that then has to be applied to that called wisdom. And we apply wisdom. And then Jesus gave us something. He gave us the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is those things that will help us to understand some of these things.
Amen.
You know, I mean, that's cool. You do what you do, boo.
I don't know about calling the other man boo, though. That's like delicious.
Hey, D.
Yeah, I don't know.
Welcome to the program.
Will be for Dante.
Hey, D.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay, yeah. You guys were talking about something earlier, the diversity and everything else like that.
Yes.
And I just noticed that I don't know if you think it's a good or a bad thing. They were talking about changing the how they're going to be doing the census. They're going to be doing North Africa, and then they're going to be doing Middle Eastern. Mm-hmm. Is that going to affect black people? I mean, if they're North African and somebody's there's some dark skin Sudanese or something like that, or mm-hmm. people from, is that going to lower our numbers or anything else along those lines? Is there going to be, and one other question I was thinking about, when they do all these kind of things, they have Hispanic and Asian and black and white and all these kind of designations. Is that going to be another crowd who's going to be getting not affirmative action, but they're going to be another group they'll have to be looking at? They'll say, we need a certain number of Middle Eastern people. We need a certain number of North Africans. There's going to be another group there. Blacks are going to be in competition with?
Well, that's a good question. I mean, I don't even know how to answer that, because
I would say no, because when people talk about competition, they're talking about jobs. Majority of the uh-huh. jobs that, you know, a lot of people that are coming from other countries are obtaining, those are the jobs that, you know, most black people that have already been born and raised here don't even want anyway. Whenever they talk about
what about the one other question? What about the companies? You know, when they when you guys are building that, I guess that I-94 or whatever extension, mm-hmm. and they said they talked about having a certain number of black people. If somebody's North African or Middle Eastern, would that be something they would take in context when they're building extension around Milwaukee or highways, or
they're
going to be building something?
They can't use race. I think the way to get around the race they use in Milwaukee is that you come from the Milwaukee community. You cannot use race. I mean, in the Supreme Court, you're not supposed to anyway. That. Yeah.
Well, I remember people hearing about they had got a certain number of percentage of black people working at. You talk about that Pfizer Stadium, mm-hmm. and they got all these black people black men working down there. Because mm-hmm. They had some black companies. Mm-hmm. What about the some company that's from that's North African or Middle Eastern? Could they say, hey, they need to use us instead of the black folks or anything?
I think if there's a challenge, but I would think that if the numerical numbers would be so low in terms of people coming from that part of the world, remember, many of those people, unless they're born here, now if they're born here, they're U.S. citizens, right? If they immigrated here, there's a different thing. And here's what this is something my wife worked for the census 2020, but here's one of the things that the Trump people were trying to do. The Trump people only wanted to count U.S. citizens. The census counts everybody that's here, regardless of citizenship status. It counts everybody that's here. And that was the big issue, because there's a nativism that Trump trumpets, this idea, because somebody wanted to change, I think it was the 14th Amendment, that said that you didn't automatically become a U.S. citizen if you were born here. You know, they start talking about anchor babies and things like, but that's such a small percentage. Most of us are here. Most of us have been here. And so.
And I have one more question. I see you're going to a break, Keith. Can you hold me over until I can ask that other question?
Sure. You're listening to Community Voice. We're going to take a break and we'll be right back.
The Hustle and Grow Show, powered by the Center for Teaching Entrepreneurship, will be Saturday, March 30th at 8 a.m. Please join us as we discuss the World Economic Forum, Heart Month, and women entrepreneurs. Then we're going to play a chocolate guessing game and debate on whether or not we think college is mandatory. So please join us for the Hustle and Grow Show, powered by the Center for Teaching Entrepreneurship, Saturday, March 30th at 8 a.m. And don't forget to check out our website at www.ctemke.org.
Easter and prom is here, and graduation is near. Stop by Nicovani's, where they have a large variety of suits, blazers, and shoes to get you right for that special day. You already know Nicovani has the $100 hookup. You can get a suit,
shirt, tie, and shoes, all for just $100. They're open 7 days a week with an on-site tailor. Nicovani's on the second floor of the Mayfair Mall across from the movie theater. It's the place to shop for men.
Hey, Milwaukee, this is Mandela Barnes. You probably know me as the former lieutenant governor, but I'm also a proud product of Milwaukee Public Schools and a proud son of a Milwaukee Public School teacher. And that's why I'm supporting Yes for MPS. We have strong public schools. We have strong communities. We have a strong workforce, and everyone can succeed. For years, we've seen Republicans in the legislature continue to fail Milwaukee students by withholding resources that force devastating cuts to our schools. This referendum is our chance to stand up for our kids and provide them with the opportunities they deserve and say yes to their futures when so many have told them no. If the referendum fails, consequences for our children, our parents, our educators, and for the future of our city will be dire. So let's do our part, Milwaukee. Join me in voting yes for MPS on April 2nd.
Paid for by the Vote Yes for MPS Committee.
On April 2nd, Milwaukee Public Schools is asking you to vote for a permanent 30% property tax increase. At a time when Milwaukee families are feeling the pinch financially, it's the wrong time for a tax increase. Students and families deserve accountability. We need a comprehensive plan from MPS with real solutions, not just a new tax. Vote no to 30% on April 2nd. Paid for by CFC Action Fund as an in-kind contribution to Enough is Enough. Vote no.
Increasing taxes while families are paying more for everything from gas to groceries is wrong. Milwaukee voters should oppose increasing property taxes by nearly 30% in order to provide increased funding yet again to Milwaukee Public Schools. They've already wasted nearly $1 billion in new taxpayer funding, and now they want more? They don't even have a plan on how they'll spend it. Enough is enough. Milwaukee voters should just say no.
Paid for by Enough is Enough. Vote no.
You're listening to WNOV 860 and W293CX 106.5 Milwaukee.
Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those that trespass against us. I'll know them again, we will never, never, never trust. Them not know what them do. They go to yai while I'm sticking like glue. Blinking green while I'm plotting for you.
Forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do.
Man, I'm telling them no.
Forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do.
For real, them not what they do.
Beware the false motives of others. Be careful of those who pretend to be brothers. And you never suppose it's those who are closest to you. To you. They say all the right things to gain their position. They use your kindness as their ammunition. To shoot you down in the name of ambition they do. Forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do.
Indian wanna be the chief, be the man till he fall, and he still want me. Give me three, try to tee forth my piece. Why for you to increase, I must decrease. If I treat you kindly, doesn't mean that I'm weak. You hear me speak and think I'ma take it to the streets. I know enough cats that don't turn the other cheek, but I try to keep it civilized like men, the league and other Africans are. Observing stars with war scars, get yours, this capitalistic system. So many core they got, but you can't list them. How you gonna idolize the missing? Survive to stay alive in the face of opposition. Even when they come in, gunning, I stay in position. I don't know the mission since conception. Let's free the people from deception. If you're looking for the answers, then you gotta ask the questions. But when I let go, my voice echoes through the ghetto. Sick of men trying to pull strings like Geppetto. While black people always be the ones to settle. March through these streets like Soweto.
Like Cain and Abel, Caesar and Brutus, Jesus and Judas, Baxter.
little while to discover.
Now, back to Community Voice with your host, Keith Paris, and Devon Jones, DJ The Protégé.
Welcome back. That was an epic song. Right
can there. I get an accident report? I got an accident report. So got witnesses. Yeah, I was attacked by the mic.
Yeah, we got cameras too. So, right, you know, ain't no...
Everybody saw that mic come at me. Remember we used to play on the playground those double poles. And
damn, you that old that you remember that?
He said, "Yeah, he always."
Oh, okay, I'm about to say. So, well, you always get on him being old. Now you remember his
man.
Stuff?
You hit one of those poles. You know what do people say? The pole don't move. Pole don't move. Call him up. Welcome back, man.
Yeah, I won't be that long. Okay. I just have a comment. I just say real quick. Then I'll ask two others. I'm like a comment and I'm a question. The one wing, I said 30% on that. They're doing 30 to 60%. They're talking about that election thing on property taxes here.
Okay.
People say, "Wow!" And the other question would be: my understanding on that when it was doing, they were doing the census, they had these Haitians coming across to this country, mm-hmm. and when they came and they did the census, they automatically put them as African American. They didn't want to be African Americans in their mind. They were not African American. They were Haitian. And there was they were not excited about being called African Americans. And when you talk about diversity, now the neighborhood I live in, I mean, I think they have some Ethiopians or they have some people, a lady from Mali. Do you have, is there any of your neighborhoods like that where you have people like that, Africans or something?
Sure.
They have a different deal?
No, I think it's sure. But remember, when you're looking at many of the African immigrants, many of those people are here.
On Sunday, May 5th, bring
business, or they're here because of education. And so obviously their income is going to put them in. But as a matter of fact, I do have just on the other side of Center Street, there are some Africans. I live in a pretty, hate to use it this way, pretty diverse neighborhood, though. So,
oh, man, I can't get over that, dog.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, you keep up with that, and I know what's on the other side of Lisbon too.
What about the Haitians? I'm not wanted to be considered.
Would you want to be considered Haitian?
No, I mean,
okay. Well,
from Haiti. I mean, they come to this country and they automatically get classified as African American or black.
Right, and that's the problem with the racial classifications.
No. See, they won. They wore. They know exactly who they are.
But I'm asking if I went someplace and would you want to be called Haitian? And if you African American, I'm thinking the answer is no. I'm African American. I'm here.
Okay.
And I'm just saying it's an ethnicity piece for me. Michelle and I were going back and forth.
I thought you weren't African American no more.
Michelle and I were going back and forth. We were going back and forth about, you know, whether it's ethnicity or race. Race is a construct. Race was created to justify. And there's a great movie I just saw. I would suggest anybody you see it called 88. It's a great movie. But they talk about this whole idea of race is a construct. Race was created to justify colonization and enslavement. But we come from various ethnic backgrounds, right? So like all white people are not just white. White people are German and Poles and Lithuanians. I mean, they have their own ethnicities, and even within there are even groups, and I want to use the term sub because we don't use that in sociology anymore. But so, yeah, the problem with us is we're 400 years removed from my ancestral homeland, so it's very difficult for me to say I'm Igbo. I don't know if I'm Igbo or not, right? So we have this generic thing we do in America, and we put everybody in as black, right? If you're of African descent. And then, so they roll the same thing with the Haitians. You have African descent, you're black. And so I think that, yeah, but Haitians are saying, look, we got our own culture. You know, we got our own history, you know, which is different than the history of mainland descendants of enslaved Africans, even though we all were enslaved. Different experiences.
I mean,
though.
They speak French.
Right.
They speak French and they eat different kinds of food, I've been told.
Yeah, they do French, Creole, and I'm trying to think Haitians.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm trying to think of the other, what is it? Patois.
That's in Jamaica.
No, it's also in Haiti.
Oh, I didn't know. I thought it was Jamaica.
Yeah, it is a hodgepodge of languages.
Yeah, they diverse.
All right, man. Well, have a good Resurrection Weekend, man. Appreciate you as always. Hey, I'm wondering, you know, if we stay transparent, bro. I'm gonna disagree.
Well, did he lie? Because he said he was gonna be short.
He was really short. You made me forget my profound thought. It must not have been.
Ooh, bubbles.
That profound. Look at
You gotta admire Keon every time I look on him with Michelle. He got a different hat on every day.
Yeah, well, he ace deucing this one.
But I've been missing out on him, you know, the past couple Fridays. And so now I get to see him in this element with a different hat on.
Yeah, he ace.
Get back in place.
Yeah.
What do you say? A flower is not a flower if it's wilted. And a hat's not a hat until it's tilted. You either got or you haven't got style. It's Robin and the Seven Hoods, baby. Robin and the Seven Hoods. Dean and Bing, baby. Dean and Bing.
Oh, I thought that was Frank Sinatra.
He was part of it.
He was part of it, Rat Pack. But no, that was Dean and Bing.
I did it my way.
Ocean's 11.
Dude, you
Ocean 11.
Da
da da da da. Who did Ocean's 11 in the original? Sammy Davis Jr. Ocean 11.
Bang Bang. He got a song called Bang Bang. I like when.
Oh, it's Robin and Seven Hoods when he's doing his gun trick. Which was part of his act. He would do that whole gun thing as part of his act.
You know, my Way. That's my favorite Sinatra song.
That's your favorite? Chairman of the Board?
Love and Marriage. Love and Marriage.
Yeah, that's another one. Oh, no. New York, New York.
New York, New York.
It's up to you.
Hey.
New
York. You like it better than My Way?
No,
a lot of people did My Way.
Elvis
did My Way, didn't he?
No, but it's Frank's song. See, because it's called, you know, at the funeral, they say he lived a Frank Sinatra lifestyle. Mm-hmm. He did it his way.
Yes. Yes. But Elvis did My Way, didn't he?
Yeah, but that don't mean he did.
But New York, New York,
but
man.
But it's a Frankie standard. It's the original Frankie.
Right.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a good one. Say? Tony Bennett. I left my heart in San Francisco.
Huh?
Oh man, we just try to mimic.
Everybody had to sing in the choir, so right?
He don't know nothing about Frank. He don't know nothing about Sinatra.
You know nothing about Frank.
Yeah.
Frankie, baby.
Frank. Yeah, Frank was the Rat Pack, and
you know I rock with him because he looked out for Nat King Cole. You know what I'm saying?
And Sammy Davis.
Mm-hmm, both of them.
Yeah. Well, Nat King Cole. Now there's a
unforgettable.
Mm-hmm. That's what you are.
Yeah.
But then, like you said, who did you say Duke and Quincy made? And he gave Quincy.
No, Count Basie.
Count and Quincy made Frank what he was.
Right. And I think
Frank was already who he was.
We're talking about his recordings.
They were the producers of his album.
Right.
Yeah. Well, we know Frankie was a made man.
Because Frank got Quincy. He was the one who called him cute.
Yeah.
Cute.
I'm in a room with some musicians. They'll tell you, game recognize game. Good musicians recognize other good musicians. And you want the best musicians playing for you. And hopefully you create a great product based on.
That's my favorite documentary.
What Marvin say? Music. Which one? It has no
Quincy.
Race.
Quincy, yeah.
Peaceful Space.
I go Quincy last.
I got
Dance,
the autobiography if you want to read it.
And then.
I got Quincy. I got Miles.
Black Godfather.
Oh, Clarence Avant. Mm-hmm. Listen. Now that Aretha movie with Jennifer Hudson, because they had a couple of them, I was just waiting to see who the band was. Ended up being some down south country white boys in the woods.
Muscle Shoals. Huh? Muscle Shoals, Alabama.
Man, listen.
Yeah.
Listen. You like, wait a minute.
Yeah, and
like Memphis. Them boys out of Memphis ain't no joke either. Elvis boys.
And the three women who did backup were sisters, white women at Stax. These three women, those are white women.
Yeah.
And this is what makes us so interested in America. There has been this argument when people get into like linguistics and kind of get into like cultural studies, they ask the question, who has the greatest influence? Was it the African influence? What is the Scott-Irish influence? I was watching Religious Porn again last night. I was watching Jimmy Swaggart, and they had Tommy Bates. Tommy Bates from Kentucky. Yeah, that's what I call it. I should be watching it. But Tommy Bates, this boy hooped. This white boy pulled it. I'm going with. Because the difference is, especially in the South, black people and white people lived among each other. And they talked about even during colonial times, in some instances, they worshiped together. And so there was this melding of worship styles that we create. That's why you go in and you get somebody like Taylor Dayne and you go, until you see her, Tina Marie.
The girl we just played, Candy Dolphin.
Yeah, until you see her, you going, wait a minute.
I seen a few Tina Maries up at Walmart.
And how about the last?
No, they just how they talk.
Portuguese.
And the last time her and Rick James played together, they both end up dying.
Right.
You're listening to Community Voice. We're up in the last break of the program. We'll be right back.
On Sunday, May 5th, bring out your spring best for the annual It's a Love Thing party for the LGBTQ community 40 and up. It's presented by Carmen A. Murguia. Come enjoy music by DJ Kelsey, a Latin dinner menu, and gift giveaways. It's a Love Thing will be held at the Wisconsin African American Women's Center on 3020 West Philippe Street from 3 to 7 p.m. Get your tickets in advance for just $25. Call Carmen at 414-534-0701. That's 414-534-0701. On Sunday, May 5th, bring out your spring best for the annual It's a Love Thing party for the LGBTQ community 40 and up. It's presented by Carmen A. Murguia. Come enjoy music by DJ Kelsey, a Latin dinner menu, and gift giveaways. It's a Love Thing will be held at the Wisconsin African American Women's Center on 3020 West Philippe Street from 3 to 7 p.m. Get your tickets in advance for just $25. Call Carmen at 414-534-0701. That's 414-534-0701.
Are you ready to take your self-care routine to new heights? Introducing Birdsong, your one-stop destination for all natural body essentials. Now open at our brand new location, 7123 West Greenfield Avenue. That's 7123 West Greenfield Avenue. Come check out an extensive collection of body oils, shea butter, soaps, hydrating lotions, refreshing shower gels, and enchanting incense. For more information, please visit birdsongsonline.com.
Don't settle for bumps, ingrowns, and itch due to dry skin. Try Venus for pubic hair and skin, the razor and regimen specifically designed for your pubic area. Featuring a razor with patent irritation defense bar and skin care regimen that is dermatologist and gynecologist tested, Venus helps protect your pubic skin from shave irritation. Discover the full regimen of products at GilletteVenus.com.
Looking for the perfect spot to unwind and hang out with your friends? Well, come visit Brownstone Social Lounge, located at 524 North Water Street, Milwaukee's premier downtown social lounge. For good vibes, great music, and delicious food, be sure to try our amazing wings and drink specials during our all-day happy hour on Tuesdays and Wednesdays. And that's not all. You can also enjoy happy hour from Thursday to Sunday from 4 p.m. until 7 p.m. For more information, please call 414-204-0103. Brownstone Social Lounge.
Hey, this is Chris Heavy Levy. I'm back. And I'm inviting you to join me every Saturday afternoon starting at 2 for the Backtracks and More show, where you'll hear my girl, and this.
How about all this and more happening right here on 860 WNOV and 106.5 FM Saturday afternoon from 2 until 6. Remember, tell a friend.
Hi, my name is Tamika Vukovic, co-executive director of Wisconsin Voices. Please join Wisconsin Voices every Monday, Tuesday, and Friday. We will be focusing on community partnerships, voter education, and long-term collective impact for all Wisconsinites.
WNOV 860 and W293CX 106.5 Milwaukee.
All right, welcome back to Community Voice. Let me thank everybody for being part of the program today. Let me thank Mr. Greg Grotz. Let me thank DJ.
Thank you.
Keon, Carvey, Debo, all the callers.
Good Friday.
Have a good Friday and a great, well, a good Lord willing, creek don't rise. Have a great resurrection weekend. He rose.
To resurrect.